all sin and gives me victory. Oh, come, angel band, come and around me stand. Oh, bear me away on your snowy wings to my immortal home. Oh, bear me away on your snowy wings to my immortal.
There is power,
wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Would you be free from the burden of sin?
There's power in the blood, power in the blood.
Would you or evil a victory win?
There's wonderful power in the blood.
Blood of the Lamb. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the sun.
Your journey is completed.
have been true. Fair and bright, your home in glory. Your enraptured soul will
unchanging hand, hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal, hold to God's unchanging hand. Unchanging hand, hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal, hold to God's unchanging.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know it's true. It satisfies my longing as nothing else can do.
I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell.
We're gathered here today as family and friends, not for a funeral, because Jerry forbid it. We're gathered today for what Jerry described or wished to be a quote-unquote light-hearted affair. That's what he wanted. He didn't want us to grieve. He wanted us to come together and celebrate. I say that, though, And I can't promise there won't be tears. I can't guarantee it will all be lighthearted, but we will celebrate a life lived well today. Would you pray with me? Father, we gather today to celebrate the life of a husband, a father, a brother, and a friend. Most importantly, we gather to celebrate a man of God. We thank you for Jerry's life and for his faithfulness to you. We thank you for the example that he set in always looking up. We know that Jerry is healed today, and that he can breathe and that he can sing praises to you again. Lord, I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for the knowledge that as much as a struggle as it was in the last days for Jerry to breathe, and I watched him as he tried to sing in this hospital bed. But Lord, I know the moment that he opened his eyes in heaven, he took a full breath and he bellowed out praise to you. And so God, we celebrate that today. And Lord, while we'll do our best to honor Jerry's request to be happy and celebrate, we can't help but be sad for the loss that we're experiencing. There is a huge hole in our hearts right now. But we ask that you fill that hole with memory, with love, and with your perfect peace. Lord, would you be with us in this service today? And would you help us to glorify you in everything that we do? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to begin by reading some scripture. As I thought about Jerry, I tried to just think about some verses that I thought would be relevant to his life and the way that he lived his life. And one that came to mind was the 28th Psalm, verses 6 through 8. And there the psalmist says, "Praise be to the Lord, for he has heard my cry for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I praise him. The Lord is the strength of his people, a fortress for his anointed one." And then in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verses 1 through 7, Jesus says to the disciples and to us as well, he says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to Jesus, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And then lastly, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8, Paul says this to Timothy, "I have fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. Now there is in store for me..." Sorry, Jerry. "There's in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." May God bless the reading of his word. It's been a rough few days, you know. I feel like you're on the verge, this big hole, trying to figure out what's next. 30 years ago, I was a rambunctious 13-year-old who started attending this church. Not long after I started attending, I was invited to a youth retreat. The first night of that retreat, there was supposed to be a time of silence. We were all supposed to go to our rooms and be quiet for the rest of the night. But myself and a couple of other boys weren't paying enough attention to get that memo, and we didn't know we were supposed to be quiet. We were laughing and we were giggling and being stupid like boys are, and somebody knocked on our room door several times and said, "You boys need to be quiet." And then I think it ramped up to, "You boys need to shut up." And the way our room was, it was divided in half and there were two doors, and one of the guys said, he said, "Hey, lock that door so nobody can get in." And so one guy went and locked the other door, and I got up and thought I locked my door, but instead of locking it, I unlocked it. A few minutes later, our door burst open, and here stands Jerry Akers in nothing but his tidy whities. And the first words out of his mouth were, "Who's sleeping with me?" Well, I'm going to tell you, when a big burly guy, nothing but his tidy whities, walks in your room and says, "Who's sleeping with me?" you have a come to Jesus moment and you start confessing everything you've ever done wrong in your entire life. That was my introduction to Jerry Akers. Next morning, through that weekend, I began to get to know a guy who wasn't that, what I thought was a rough, burly guy that night, but a guy who loved Jesus and loved to praise Him. Over the years, I got to know a guy who never met a stranger, a guy who loved car shows and drag races. And man, he would go wherever he needed to go to a drag race or a car show. Met a guy who loved hanging out with friends. I got to know a guy who loved to travel but never took a main road to get anywhere. What fun was the trip if it wasn't an experience, I think was his motto. I always called Jerry my cleaned up hippie friend because he was a leftover from the 60s and 70s. He just, he kind of had that attitude but not the hair anymore. If the wind was blowing south when Jerry woke up, he might decide spur of the moment to hop on a plane and fly to Florida. I can't tell you how many times he called me on Friday to let me know that he was getting ready to get on a plane and say, "When'd you decide to fly?" He said, "Oh, this morning when I got up. So I'm going to fly down to Florida, but I should be back in time for praise and worship on Sunday morning. My flight gets in at 10 o'clock or whatever." And he'd come barreling in here and play a guitar. Everybody who knows Jerry knows he was a phenomenal musician and vocalist. He was one of the few people on earth who had perfect pitch. You could play a note on the piano and he could tell you what note it was just by listening to it. He despised sheet music. I learned over the years, don't print off sheet music to hand it to Jerry Akers because sheet music just makes him mad. He would say, "Don't give me that." He'd say, "Just play the song." We'd play the song, and 30 seconds in, he'd have the song down. It always just blew my mind how talented he was. Praise team practice was always interesting because he might get a tune in his head at the end of a song we were singing, and next thing you know, the praise team practice turns into a 15-minute long jam session where they're going all over the place and singing all kinds of old songs, and the rest of us are just kind of standing there just watching because we can't do what he would do. But you know, beyond music and travel and his happy-go-lucky personality, there are two things that I most appreciated about Jerry. Number one is his faith. He trusted God like few people that I know. He believed in the power of God's Word, which is why he joined the Gideons years ago. He believed that God's Word is powerful and that it doesn't return void. He had absolute, unwavering faith in God's ability to do anything. I have to tell you, in the 3 years that he had cancer, I think I heard him say the word cancer maybe twice. He didn't want to talk about it. He was not focused on what he had. He was focused on where he was going. And he got mad if you asked him anything to do with it. I learned the hard way. Don't ask Jerry if he's feeling okay, because he would say, "How should I be feeling?" Well, I'm just asking, you know. Or if you say, "Hey, Jerry, how you doing?" "I'm great." He was always just great. But Jerry backed up his faith with his pocketbook, supporting many things with his prayers and his finances, from missionaries to the church to special projects. Jerry refused to let cancer define him. And so his faith is number one. The second thing that I appreciate about Jerry personally is his friendship. Over the years, Jerry served on our board as a trustee. He's always been on the praise team as long as I've been part of the church, 30 plus years. On our maintenance team, you name it, does a little bit of everything. But one thing I never doubted for a second was that Jerry was in my corner. We didn't always get along. We didn't always agree on every little thing. But I always knew that he was in my corner and that he had my back. He encouraged me. He prayed for me. Sometimes he told me to get over myself. If I'd be complaining about something, I remember one time I was complaining about something, and he said, "Let me ask you a question, Brian." I said, "What?" He said, "At the end of the day, does that matter?" I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "Does it matter? Is anybody going to get saved or lost over it?" I said, "No." He said, "Then what do you care?" I was like, "I don't know. It's important to me." He said, "Well, it shouldn't be." And so he was a great encourager. Jerry's promotion to heaven leaves a hole that will be very difficult, if not impossible, to fill. But I'm thankful for the promise that we will see him again. That this is not goodbye. We're not coming here today to say goodbye, Jerry Akers. We're coming here to say, "Hey man, we're glad you got there first. But we'll see you soon. We'll see him again." And I'm thankful for that. This time Mark Waldron's going to come and sing a song for us.
All right. Now, Seth, you got to give me some light up here because I can't see a thing. Especially on this podium here with some words on it. I don't know if that'll help or not. I may have to get overhead. But anyway, the reason I got Jerry's guitar up here is that, you know, as being part of the praise team, we started out, and you know that Jerry always, he was a people person, as Brian was talking about. He loved talking to people. And when we got to the praise team going, you know, back before COVID, we would always have a greeting time. And there you go. And when we got to where, at this church, greeting time would run a long time sometimes, you know. And so we got to where we were sort of standing around a little bit too much. But Brian said, "Well, how about the praise team? As soon as the greeting time starts, praise team, come on up here and get ready." And so, you know, when things settle down a little bit, we start right in singing. Well, that seemed to work pretty good for most people except Jerry, because he loved to greet everybody. He was cutting into his time. So most of the time, the praise team would come up here, and we'd be standing around. They'd say, "Well, where's Jerry at?" And, you know, he's back there talking to this one or that one or whatever. And sometimes we'd have to start playing. But then Jerry would get up here, and he'd pick up his guitar, and then if it was the first service, he'd have to tune it, you know, so we stand around. So at this time, this guitar hadn't been picked up for a long time, so I'm going to have to tune this guitar probably before I start the song. So y'all bear with me here just a minute. Oh, my. That's probably close enough. The song I'm going to sing is, I'm going to cover one of Jerry's songs. And that's the flattering hymn, because the first time I really heard this song, it's an old song, but I heard it and it stuck with me. And it's a life that he lived, I know, because just the words in the song just kind of speak to the life that he lived. And it was always Jesus and me. And so just listen to sing. Well, hold on. Man, I'm not as good as tuning as Jerry was. I traveled alone upon this lonesome way. My burdens were heavy and dark was my day. I looked for a friend, not knowing that he had all of the time been looking for me. And now it's Jesus and me. For each tomorrow, for every heartache and every sorrow, I know that I can depend upon my newfound friend. And so till the end, it's Jesus and me. The road may be long to heaven's pearly gates. I know that it's narrow, I know that it's straight, but Jesus is there through eternity. We'll travel along, just Jesus and me. So now it's Jesus and me, for each tomorrow, for every heartache and every sorrow, I know that I can depend upon my newfound friend. And so till the end, it's Jesus and me. Forever I'll sing of his great love for me. Forever I'll tell it on land and on sea. I'll stay by his side, contented I'll be for all of my life. It's Jesus and me. It's for now, it's Jesus and me. For each tomorrow, for every heartache and every sorrow, I know that I can depend upon my newfound friend. And so to the end,
Jesus. Thank you, Mark. I'd also like to welcome all those who are watching online with us today. We are at this time going to take a few minutes to give you an opportunity if you would like to share a memory that you have. I am going to ask Mark, could you do me a favor? Could you bring a mic down here? I'm going to ask you to come up to the mic if you would like to share, just because we have so many people online who are watching and we want them to be able to hear what you have to say. So, but if you have a memory that you'd like to share of Jerry, or just a thought, or just a thought for the family at this time, if you would be willing to come forward, or I guess Mark could take it to you if you don't mind. We can also bring the mic to you. If you would just stand where you are, we'll do that.
I tell you, Jerry was just, he was just more than a friend. He was everybody's friend, but he was just such a, you know, an intimate part of the church, you know. And I remember I started coming here in I think 1999. And the church was turning around then, and when I walked in and the music started, it was this skinny guy with black hair playing at the same bass, that white bass, and beside Barbara on the piano. And man, he'd been doing it ever since. I mean, it just, and I went and talked to him because I like music, so I went and talked to Jerry. I met him right after the service, you know, and became good friends ever since. Been playing and singing with him. Me and him, Mark, have, you know, we've done a lot of specials and a lot of crazy things together, you know, as far as music and all that. And it's just going to be a different world without Jerry, you know. But I love him, as we all do, and I thank the Lord that, you know, he put Jerry in my life, and, you know, not just as a friend, but as a mentor. And, you know, I play the drums, and daggone, if, you know, if we was off beat a little bit, Jerry had that foot going, you know, and he'd always get us, you know, get us back in the rhythm again. But I love him, gonna miss him.
Up here, Mark, the front.
Yeah, Jerry was my brother. We fought like cats and dogs with my other brother. We had to be separated a lot of times, but we had good times, and I miss him too.
Anyone else?
Tell you, I'm looking around the room right here, and I can promise you there's not a soul in here that Jerry didn't pray for. When I first started coming to church here, there was like three or four guys that I picked out, and I watched every move they made, how they talked, how they interacted with people, and, you know, how they prayed. And Jerry was one of them. And I'm gonna miss Jerry, but I'm really gonna miss us, just me and him sitting down praying for everything that's going on at the time. He was one of the people that I could just, that I could definitely just say, Jerry, I need to pray with somebody, and he wouldn't hesitate, not one second. And, I just loved him.
Anyone else before we move on?
I got to share this. What a privilege it was to stand next to him for praise and worship for all those years. And as the Lord's called us to go to Mount Calvary and work up there, what Jerry was such an encouragement to me. But Sunday, Barbara and I decided we would sing one of his favorite songs in church, Higher Ground. And I never will forget, we do that second verse where it says, I have no desire to stay, and Jerry would always shout out, no! And y'all might remember, it was a little cloudy Sunday, but we got to that second verse and started singing it, and the sun came through the window. And I got glory bumps and felt the best I've felt all week just for that verse. And we finished and went back to verse 3, and the clouds came back. But that's a precious memory. And every time I hear that song, I will always think of Jerry. Can't wait to see him again.
Anybody else? in the back.
Jerry, I'm going to miss you, man. My friend, I've been with you through thick and thin all these years, for 40-some years, knowing you. And God bless you, and I'll see you again in heaven, Jerry. Thank you for everything. You've been with me through trials. I've been with you through trials. And God bless you, Jerry. God bless Vicki and the family.
My name is Lois Hinkle. I was Jerry's teacher in elementary school many years ago. He was a character, and I loved him. And I am so glad that I came today to hear what a wonderful young man he turned out to be. I had no idea he was a musician. I didn't remember that in school. But it's wonderful to hear all the wonderful things that you people are talking about Jerry. I am so glad he was a part of my life.
Well, there's one thing you know about Jerry. If you spent any time with him, he would not abide passing judgment on anybody. He would shut you down real quick. If you were saying something negative about somebody, he would shut you up real quick. And I appreciated that about him. Well, I once asked Jerry how he ended up here at Riverside, and he told me that he was going through a really rough patch in his life. He was drinking heavily and things weren't good. But one day he was riding down the road and he saw the church and he thought, I'm going to stop there. And he said he walked through the doors of the church and he finally found what he was looking for. And he never went back. Not that he never went back to church. He never went back to the life that he was living. It was as simple as that. I'm sure thankful that he did, because as you've heard today, the impact that he had in this church and will continue to have, because his impact doesn't stop. The beautiful thing about this life that we live is the impact that we have doesn't stop when we pass away. We leave a legacy that carries on after us, and you know, it may be the legacy that's left through kids who are inspired to play music because he played music, or people that are inspired to do things because Jerry did them, and I appreciate that. Well, one of my favorite passages is one that we opened the service with, John 14. In that passage, Jesus reminds us that in his Father's house are many mansions or rooms. He comforts us by telling us that he's gone to prepare a place for us, and he promises that he will come back to take us to be with him where he is or where he will be. He reminds the disciples that they know the way to the place where he's going, and Thomas, ever the one with questions, says, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Well, before I get to Jesus' response to Thomas, I just want to point out a couple of things here. First, Jesus has a place for you in his kingdom. A property just for you. A house with your name on it. No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, or how many times you've said no to his gentle calling. Maybe, Maybe you don't feel worthy of that promise. Well, good. Because none of us are worthy of that promise. The Bible says that we are sinners and our sin has separated us from God. Maybe you're on the opposite side of the spectrum here today and you think that you've earned the key to your mansion through your good works by being a good person. The Bible says that our best goodness is as filthy rags in God's sight. No amount of good works on our part can merit us a place in God's heaven. But the good news is that Jesus Himself has made preparations for us. He says, "In my Father's house are many rooms. I go to prepare a place for you." He did the work that we couldn't do. He prepared the place that we couldn't prepare on our own. And He did that by dying on the cross for our sins, taking the death sentence that we all deserve for our sinfulness. He took our sins into the grave with Him in His death. And when He rose 3 days later, He left our sins there. And that's the good news. And so He's prepared a place for us. We just have to know the way to get there. Thomas didn't know the way, and so he asked Jesus. And what was Jesus' response to Thomas? He said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus is the only way to the Father. The only way we can have a relationship with God is through Jesus. The only way that we can merit heaven, eternal life, is through Jesus. Jesus radically changed Jerry's life. He was different. He wasn't perfect. None of us are perfect. But he was a different person. Jerry's life is a testament to the gospel, to the good news. I'm thankful for the impact that Jerry had on my life, and I hope someday somebody will look over my life and I'll have just an iota of the impact that he had on the people around him. I'm thankful for the Jesus who shines so brightly through him, and I hope that today we can all learn from him. We're going to close our service with one last song. You may need to make sure the CD player's turned up too, Seth.
When you get to heaven, after the trumpet sounds, if you decide to look me up, don't waste your time looking round. I won't be in my mansion, you won't find me by the sea, just find Jesus. There I'll be. I wanna see the unseen arms that held me through the storms. I wanna touch the hand that touched and completely changed my heart. I wanna hear Him speak the words that brought such peace to me. So just find Jesus, and there I'll be. When I step through those pearly gates, there'll be so much to see. I'll behold mansions tall and stroll down golden streets. Though the splendor will be amazing, there's only one attraction for me. So just find Jesus, there I'll be. I wanna see the unseen arms that held me through the storms. I wanna touch the hand that touched and completely changed my heart. I wanna hear Him speak the words that brought such peace to me. So just find Jesus, there I'll be. Just find Jesus, there I'll be.
Bow with me as we close this portion of our time with prayer. Father, thank you for this time of celebration today. Thank you for Jerry. Thank you for the example that he set for us all. Lord, would you be with Vicky, with Jesse, with Chuck, and with Lynn, and all the rest of the family. Comfort them in their sorrow and give them peace. Be with us now, O God, as we progress to the graveside. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And our service will be concluded at the graveside. Those of you who joined us online, we appreciate you joining us as well.
Hallow our days in the sweet.